In the previous discussion, we talked about situations with multiple equilibria, one where the city doesn't exist and the other where the city is big. City leaders sometimes allude to these types of forces as an excuse for national interventions, to give their location an extra boost. But does the existence of agglomeration economies really mean that cities are too small? Conversely, do negative urban externalities mean that cities are too big? Generally speaking, economists think that people do too little of unpaid activities that yield positive benefits to others, like shoveling snow from their sidewalks, and too much of activities that generate negative consequences for others, like driving on congested roads. Arthur Cecil Pigou is the economist who emphasized this most. A lot of urban policy is just an application of this principle. Economists like congestion pricing of roads because that corrects the negative externality associated with driving. In some cases, charging a price, which is called a Pigouvian tax, is feasible. In other cases, we are forced to use quantity regulations, like only allowing cars with even-numbered license plates to drive on Mondays and Wednesdays, and only cars with odd-numbered license plates to drive on Tuesdays and Thursdays. Given the obvious inefficiency of number plate regulations, you can understand why economists like plain, honest congestion prices. But you can also imagine that the number regulation is easier to enforce. And that will often be true about quantity regulations. A bright line rule that says that you can never hunt out of season is considerably easier to enforce than a complicated pricing scheme that requires higher hunting license fees on some days than on others. In countries with weak institutions, it is particularly important to think about the difficulties with enforcement. Okay, following this detour, let's go back to the welfare consequences of city bigness. If each person coming to a city yields benefits or costs to the existing residents, isn't that a reason to subsidize or tax the city's growth? Maybe. But what about the place that the person left behind? When you move from place A to place B, you impact both locations. And before you can have a national policy to subsidize one or the other place, you had better be sure that the agglomeration effects or negative externalities are bigger in one area than the other. As an example of this, consider moving from a subsistence farm in a poor country to an overcrowded megacity. Moving to the city increases congestion and maybe disease risk. That's bad. But the move also increases the amount of land per capita back on the farm, and that's good. If the farmer doesn't own his land, but shares in communal property, then the move really does generate positive externalities for his former neighbors. So to know if the city is too big or too small, you've got to know if the downsides of urban congestion are bigger or smaller than the benefits of having more land in the rural area. And you can't know that without a lot more data.